We have a very special guest just today. Thank you for showing up. Please check tomorrow for announcements. There may or may not be quiz that might be based on something you hear today. So there might be a keyword that you want to listen to. So make sure you check your email guest today. I'm really excited. I think this is going to be a lot of fun. I think you're going to get a lot out of this. Is a writer and a comedian and a performer. Asterios Coquinos.
That's right.
And I'll leave anything else to you.
That's great. Of course. Hey, thank you.
I really appreciate you coming and visiting the class.
That's perfect. Thanks.
I got to turn it around.
All right. Hey, everybody.
There we go.
Sorry, I'm also streaming this so that people who can't afford college can see the class too. Hey, everybody. My name is Asterios Coquinos. I've been a professional writer for about 20 years. And I've written television, books, for video games, a lot of marketing. It's nothing you've heard of, but it's a lot of fun. And storytelling is kind of the way I pay my rent in New York. And so that's kind of what we're going to be talking about today. This is an ethics and technology class. And so, you know, we're going to be discussing ethics, fantasy, and storytelling, fantasy fiction, school, and stuff, problems of tomorrow today. So, you know, like, this is boring. Like, when you think of, like, an ethics book, you think of, like, something that you don't want to read that is old and boring. When you think of an ethics lecture, you think of just a guy, like, bloviating, like I'm doing right now in front of a bunch of kids. But this is not boring right here. You know, like, we all know that, like, Star Wars is steeped in very basic good and evil ethics. This guy wants power, he wants control, this person is standing for freedom, he wants people to have individual free will. Very simple, very basic. The Empire, they want to control what you can do and think and write and feel. They use technology to do it. The Death Star, literally a technological terror. There are people out there that stand for freedom, justice, rebellion. Very basic. There is something interesting about fantasy, science fiction. They allow us to discuss or go to like a 2-hour ethics seminar on your Saturday if you're just like a mom or a dad. But you'll definitely watch a movie or you'll watch a television show. And these are kind of, I mean, it's sort of the same thing. It's like you're sitting down for 2 hours and you're pondering ethics and morality. A lot of times with shows like Black Mirror, the intersection of ethics, morality, and technology in ways that you might not choose to otherwise. You know, think of Star Trek. Who can name this guy? Who is this?
Spock.
That's Spock? Okay, who doesn't know who this is? Raise your hand. Okay, that's okay. Well, Star Trek is a piece of media that has inspired a ton of ethical, philosophical, and moral research. It's like, this was just me Googling Star Trek book ethics for 5 minutes, and I found all these books. You know, is data human, the economy, psychology. There's something about storytelling that inspires these kind of greater conversations. So that's what I want to do today. We're going to watch some clips from some movies, and we're going to kind of tease apart the ethical and moral conundrums inherent within. Just kind of see what everybody thinks. The first film is called The Dark Knight. Who here has seen The Dark Knight, the original Dark Knight? Okay. Anybody hasn't? Anybody has seen The Dark Knight?
Hasn't.
Yeah, have you not? It's okay. Do you guys know what the Joker is?
Yep.
Okay. Can I get a volunteer? Can I get some of this stuff on the board? Anybody nice? Anybody can help me out? Can you help me out? Okay. I'd like to come up with a list right now of everything bad we can think of that the Joker has done. Who's got something to start? What's the Joker done that's bad?
Murdering some people.
He murders, can you name anybody specific?
Not off the top of my head.
Okay, well, he murders the district attorney in this movie, okay. Played by Maggie Gyllenhaal. Who else can name something terrible? Can you write down murdered Maggie Gyllenhaal? What else has the Joker done?
He had to put people in that compromised position. He had them on the two boats, and one was filled with regular civilians, and the other one was filled with
Yes.
And he said that you guys have to choose who's going to die. And you have to, every day, either one is the choice that you have to vote for.
Yes, exactly. He literally used that to write down boat murder puzzle. Like, he literally used technology. He had these remote control phones. And he put people through, like, a trolley problem in real life in fiction. Yeah, that's great. Anybody remember when he blew up that hospital?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what else is the joke? And now, take it outside of this movie. You've all seen media with the Joker in it. Name some bad stuff the Joker's done. Remember in Batman 89 when he released all that poison gas on the people in Gotham Square and they all laughed themselves to death? Huh? Okay, what else? You guys ever seen Batman cartoons, read Batman comics? Remember when the Joker killed the entire audience of the David Letterman show? He did do that. He killed 700 people. What else has the Joker done? Come on. One more thing before we move on. And if you want, Google bad stuff the Joker's done on your phone. Go ahead. What do you got?
Didn't he, like, cut someone's mouth open? Like, yeah.
Yeah, he cuts people's mouths open to make them smile. And he thinks that's funny. Cuts mouths open. Perfect. Okay, good. So, here's one. So, the Joker is a... Thank you. You can sit down now. That's perfect. Thank you so much. So, we can all agree the Joker is an immoral person committing immoral acts. Can we all agree on that? Who remembers how Batman finds the Joker in this movie? If you don't remember, that's okay, because I'm going to show you.
Oh, that machine.
Yup.
Cell phone, something.
Yup.
Turn every cell phone in Gotham into a microphone.
Frequency generator receiver.
You took my sonar concept and applied it to every phone in the city. You have to say the city sonar, you can hear it all of Gotham. This is wrong.
Remember that scene from when you saw the movie? Now that you've seen the scene?
Yep.
Exactly. So, what are the moral and ethical implications of using technology in this way? Or I guess, just to start the conversation, is that like talk with all you guys? Like, I don't know any of these answers. I think it's kind of interesting we all figure out what we think together. Is it moral to hack into 30 million people's phones to find the Joker? Yes or no? And what do you think and why? What do you think?
I think it is moral because they're using it to find a person who's doing immoral acts. Mm-hmm. And like the federal government does it every day to catch terrorists. So.
And do you think it's moral?
Yeah, because they're not using it to do anything else.
You don't know that. Would you care to elaborate? Yeah. He found out that he had to find more on American people rather than to emails at Trump College. That's literally why he was in. Yeah, Snowden, I'm just a writer, I'm not a policy expert, but I believe he found out that we were using the tools that we're only supposed to use internationally, domestically. And of course, the justification we gave was, much like in this situation where there's a guy committing horrible acts, the justification was the September 11th attacks. You know, thousands of people died, innocent people out of nowhere, people were just going to work. So, it was obviously a terribly immoral act. So an act was done in response to it. Was that act moral? You know? But let's not talk about the real life. Let's kind of stick it more in fantasy, because again, fantasy is like a really interesting way to explore this stuff, you know, and kind of see what we think. Who else has an opinion about this? Is it right for Batman to hack into everybody's phone at once to find the Joker? Well, what do you guys think of the back?
Of course, every story has two sides of it, positive and negative. In a way, if you think about it, yes, he is trying to do a favor to the people and trying to save everyone from Joker. Or trying to get Joker, basically.
Mm-hmm.
But however, who gives him the right to do this? Like, to hack into everybody's cell phone and, you know, do whatever he is doing?
I think that's a very good point. Now, just to put an extra layer of complexity on it, let's say the Joker kidnapped your mom, your dad, your kid. Let's say your kid is on that boat. Does this change how you approach it? Does this change your moral calculus? And if so, should it? And what do you got to say, young man?
I don't think it should change, because ethically, everyone should have consent to know that they're going to be spied, according to law. So if he's going to spy on 30 million people, he's going to have to actually
Yeah, of course. And, you know, a lot of people are bringing up the law. But we all know that laws, just because it's legal, doesn't mean it's moral. And it's kind of our job to kind of figure that out. We all know that, you know, as long as 50 years ago, there were laws that said certain people couldn't get married to each other. You know what I mean? It's like, well, those were legal. Make them moral. What do you got to say? And then, Gunny, you wanted to say something too in the back. What did you want to say?
I was going to agree that I think it's immoral. I mean, if my mom, I guess, wasn't on there, then I would think it's immoral. But obviously, if it was a family member, I would probably change my compass.
Isn't that interesting? Like, if it's someone you know, or if you're on that boat, it's like, break every law there is to get me what? There's a ticking clock. Break every law there is in order to get me safety or someone I love safety. Then again, the natural extension of something like that can lead to pretty dark ends. I mean, everybody's always well-intentioned when they head down a path they might not yet realize is immoral. Yes, sir.
But at the same time, the act that Batman has done, nobody knows except for Batman and this guy over here. I forgot his name.
Lucius Fox,
yeah. Except for Lucius Fox and Batman himself, nobody knows how they're gonna catch Joker and what's the strategy they're using. So it's basically like, you know, using the strategy of, like, you know, noble lie. Like, you are actually doing something in terms of saving something big. Although that thing is not the exact thing you should be doing, but just for a bigger profit or for a bigger solution, you are doing it. Nobody knows it, just you, and in this case, Fox knows it.
That is very, very interesting. That's a really good point. It's not like they're projecting everybody's information on the movie in a movie theater screen. It's not like they're putting everybody's information on the web. This information is only limited to these two people. Mm-hmm. Does that change how anybody thinks about this?
Well, it doesn't make it more anyway, because Even though people doesn't know it, the fact that they don't know it doesn't make it moral.
Well, I mean, the obvious response to that is, well, how do we know that only these two people know? How do we know that someone else hasn't tapped into this machine? How do we know that, like, even these guys don't know that the data is being backed up somewhere, it's being backed up somewhere? You know, when WikiLeaks dumps a bunch of information, they think they've redacted everything, but often the Department of Defense refuses to work with WikiLeaks to properly redact that information, because they're saying, we don't want to work with you guys. You stole a bunch of information from us and you're going to put it out there, you know, which can lead to the burning of sources and possibly even deaths. But then again, when that information is leaked and we find out that all of our webcams at once, like, can be accessed by the CIA, and that in our most intimate moments, we might be being spied on, I don't think I need to get get super specific, but there's all stuff we do in the privacy of our own home that we don't want someone else looking at, regardless if somewhere down the line it might save a life. Someone was raising their hand. I was over talking. Sorry. Someone was raising their hand over here. Yes, young man.
But at the same time, after getting the Joker, didn't they burn out the whole thing, the whole system? Like, they just...
Yes.
So, doesn't that make it fair? At the same time, they're not keeping it, though.
That is what makes this such an interesting puzzle. Because, yes, again, the cat has the Joker, he types in the name Lucius, the machine explodes. So you're supposed to leave the movie going, they did a good thing. But it's like... He can hit that machine again at any time. He didn't hit himself in the head with a coconut so like he could forget how to hack everyone's phone at once. And also, is doing something immoral just one time totally cool? In this movie, they present it as such. But what if this didn't work? Like, that's the thing. When you watch a show like 24 and there's a torture scene, it always works. They find the Joker. But it's like, you gotta think to yourself, how many times has technology been used that led down a rabbit hole that led nowhere? You want to say something?
Yeah, I was gonna say, like what you said earlier, you don't know if that machine is sending data out somewhere else. So even if it got destroyed at the end, you know, it still might be somewhere else.
Yeah, I mean, think about what happens in the very next movie. Bane finds all of Batman's stuff and uses it to enslave Gotham City. Remember that?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like, oh, in this movie, oh, me and Lucius Fox are having a high-minded conversation. And Lucius is also like, I'll do it, but I'm gonna resign. And that, I'm not an ethicist, but I'm a storyteller. That's interesting to me, because he's saying I'm gonna resign kind of as a way to soothe his own conscience. He's still doing the thing. He's still gonna help, I'll call you in a second. He's still gonna help Batman find the Joker. But oh, after I'm gonna resign, I'll only torture one person. I'll only rob this one bank. It's very interesting. Yeah, so we haven't heard from you yet.
Well, I think he's like, so basically, he's basically shifting all the blame onto Batman himself and making him feel the guilt that he's forcing a person to do what he doesn't want to do.
And Batman is also shifting this onto Lucius. Because Batman's like, I need you to use this computer. Couldn't Alfred, like, just sit at this computer? Like, Batman has clearly made a computer. Like, look at it.
At the Boy Scouts of America, our hope remains. A scout pledges to be kind, helpful, and brave. We're committed to providing a safe and welcoming environment where scouts can establish the foundations of character that will last a lifetime. Visit scouts.org to learn more.
Okay, so it's like, look, Batman built this computer. You know what I mean? Batman is enlisting Lucius as kind of a way to soothe his own conscience about this, I think. You know what I mean? Like, these are two guys who are, but again, I can sit here and blather. We can all talk about this like in a high-minded sense. We can't forget all this stuff the Joker did. Did you guys see the new Joker movie? Okay. He doesn't do great stuff in it.
Yeah.
He's not a great guy. So it's like, these two guys are having this conversation, and they're kind of passing the moral baton back and forth to soothe their own conscience. Do they need the other one to justify what they're doing? Is that why Batman's asking Lucius? Batman, clearly he knows how to make an AI-powered gyrocopter because he does it at the end of the movie with Bane. Like, Batman tells his car to show up. Like, clearly Batman can, he could probably make the computer do this. I think he's using Lucius as kind of a moral fig leaf. Yes, young man, yes.
I was going to say also, what about the fact that Joker has like a mental illness? You know, like that's the disability. Yes or no, you know, that's like also begs the question, right?
Oh, how do we bring technology into it? Like, there's been plenty of moral discussions, like in classrooms just like this, should the Joker be given the death penalty? He's killed a lot of people, but he's also mentally ill. And if and once you start killing the mentally ill because they present gigantic problems, sometimes you narrow that aperture more and more until you're doing it to people who simply annoy you or may, you know, be an annoying society. But if you could attach a bracelet to the Joker that every time, if you could attach a bracelet to the Joker that could alter his brain chemistry so he didn't want to murder people anymore, would that be a moral or ethical act? If yes, why? If no, why? Like, I feel like that might be a good way to ground this discussion. You know, you can change people's brain chemistry with magnets. We've all read articles and headlines about, like, you can disable someone's morality, someone of sleep, essentially depriving their brain of a certain chemical, much like you would deprive a computer of power until it starts to do what you want or not want. What do you got to say, man?
Well, I think it depends on, like, if they have committed any crimes or not.
It's the Joker. Let's see, that's why this is interesting. Let's say it's the Joker.
Well, if we're taking a person's right to freedom. That's my opinion. Like, if you put that person in prison, or we could even, like, imprison him for his whole life, but I still think we shouldn't take away a person's freedom.
Essentially, it's freedom to think.
Yeah.
Using technology to limit someone's freedom to think. You know, right now there's a gigantic, I'll call you a second, right now there's a gigantic debate over freedom of expression on the internet with respect to Hong Kong and China. You know, if you live in China right now, you can't post certain things on the internet. I don't know what I'm talking about. Yes, young man.
I was going to say that we normally would take their freedom in another way, even if we don't take it mentally. We would just lock them away in a box in isolation or something like that. Way of thinking, that would be great, because then he would still have his freedom to roam around and do whatever he'd like.
That's interesting. You know what I mean? If you create a bracelet that essentially changed his, altered his brain chemistry so he's no longer a murderer, well, that's interesting. Now, there was a technology like this, lobotomy. Like, it was technology. It was cutting-edge technology, and we all saw it as the answer to our prayers. Like, severing part of someone's brain to change their behavior in a way that benefits society. In this specific case, changing their behavior in a way that prevents hundreds and thousands of murders. I want to hear from him, and then I want to hear from you. Yeah.
I think it's still...
That's about to bring us to our next movie, actually. But real quick from you guys.
When you really think about it, like, trying to change someone's whole mindset on the way, like, they go about life, do you really, like, have the right to, like, change someone's personality when it comes to that?
That's what makes this question so interesting. Do we have the right to alter someone's brain chemistry and personality in a way that we all see as morally good? We live in a society. We've all seen that meme. But, like, the idea is, well, in a society, the reason we have a society is that murderers get put in jail. Yes, young man. And then I want to get to the next movie, because we don't have a lot of time.
I think he should come from within, because according to what we were studying, we're saying about the Mohammed camp, and the fact that morality is the same no matter what. I think instead of doing your bottom, you should change so much brain. It doesn't matter if you're good or bad, you know that moral values are the same.
It's a very interesting question. Like, because you can tease it out a million ways. No, you should put this guy in jail forever. Well, that costs a couple of million dollars. You know how much money it would take to watch over the Joker? How many times has the Joker escaped from prison? Every time.
Yeah.
Like, so could that money be put, and you can always get into whataboutism, which is like a very dangerous rhetorical technique.
you know, what about a kid with cancer? Shouldn't the state's money go towards that? Wouldn't it be cheaper to do what they did? My grandpa was from China, and he barely escaped the Cultural Revolution of his life. What Chairman Mao was doing was he would, if there was a criminal, he would kill them with a bullet, and then he would bill the family for the bullet. Like, well, that's a much cheaper way to take care of somebody who society and the state deems as a problem. You know, freeing up those resources to go towards something else. Is that moral? Like, we've taken care of this problem for a dollar. But what have we done to ourselves? Like, it's easy to think about what should we do to the Joker to keep us safe. But the interesting thing that, like, storytelling often looks into is how does the exercise of power affect us? Like, are we, like, Lucius Fox commits an act that he clearly thinks is immoral in this movie, but he does it. Find the Joker. What's the rest of his life like? Can he look himself in the mirror? Does he think of himself as like a bad person forever? If you start thinking of yourself a bad person, it becomes easier to commit bad acts. All right, but let's get to the next movie. I don't know how long this class is, and I brought a bunch of clips. All right. Okay, let's see. All right. Who's heard of the movie Minority Report? One, two, three, four. Oh, here's the trick. This is something that fiction does that is so nice. You can just drop a moral question in the middle of a story and spend 2 hours exploring it. If you're like a mom or dad, you might not take 2 hours out of your day to just think of a moral puzzle or conundrum.
That's a point.
But take a look at what this does.
Look at me. Positive, Howard Marks. I'm placing you under arrest for the future murder of Sarah Marks and Ronald Dumino's. Take place today, April 22nd. It's 0800 hours and 4 minutes.
So this takes place in the future. It's based on, I believe, a Philip K. Dick novel. There's a division of federal law enforcement called the pre-crime division. Here's how it works. They have psychics. These psychics know who's going to commit a crime. So what Tom Cruise and the pre-crime cops do is they bust you before you commit the crime. Let me show you how it works. We're not going to watch this whole scene, but...
Steve! We got a problem with our location.
Slow of wish. Time frame?
13 minutes.
There's a ticking clock. In storytelling, there's always a ticking clock, and you can use a ticking clock to justify anything. Who's gonna murder someone?
I got something. Thank you. Danny, 20 for the fat. Oops. Got him.
Sorry, Danny, I'm gonna have to get
first. The marks coming a couple of weeks ago. Nobody knows where. Still searching for family in the quarter.
Time horizon 12 minutes.
What he's doing now, we're scrubbing the image, looking for clues as to where the murder's going to happen.
Original running bomb break pattern, streamlined early Georgia details.
And the station?
Under God,
shall
the victims are pronounced here, killers here. Beyond that, the day of the crime, all we have to run on are the images that they produce.
These are the psychics.
In the capital?
Congress.
Come on.
Georgetown. The precogs can see a murder 4 days out. Why don't they call?
Let me call it Red Ball. The crimes of passions.
So they figure out how the murder's gonna happen. They all drop into the middle of this neighborhood in full riot gear.
Shut up, Amon.
Jeff?
Who are you?
Hey, close the front door.
What?
Steve Burks, close the front door!
Someone's going to commit a crime, is it moral, ethical, and right to stop them from doing something they haven't done? You could make it interesting and exciting. You could put Tom Cruise in it. This movie's directed by Steven Spielberg, like one of the best directors ever. You got the camera moving around. There's a guy doing stuff with gloves. It's all super interesting and engaging. Well, what do you guys think? Is the pre-crime division moral?
I'd say, I don't know whether it's moral or not, but everybody has their reasons. For instance, in this case, this guy was about to kill the woman because he saw what was going on.
Yeah, he was about to kill his wife.
Yeah, and because he was about to doing it because, you know, she was cheating on him.
It was a crime of passion, yes.
Yes. Now, we can definitely make a judgment based on looking at the scene. Until you put yourself into that sort of situation and into that shoes, what you would have done if you were in that situation.
That's very interesting. I think that's why, I'm definitely gonna cut because I haven't heard me yet. I think that's why they present this situation, because it's very relatable. And in storytelling, you can do all kinds of stuff to make people think and feel a certain way. Like, let me see if I can, what is the thing? Like, sorry, let me see if I can, I can't do it. But anyway, like, you'll notice that, like, this dude who was about to murder people looked like an evil nerd. The dude whose wife was sleeping with was like a super hunky guy. So, like, this movie can, like storytelling can play little tricks on you to get you. Maybe you're on the side of this murderer for a second, and you're thinking to yourself, like, yeah, I might do that too. Like, my wife was cheating with, like, a much hotter dude. I might get angry enough to kill somebody. But I didn't kill them, though. And why am I being punished for something I haven't done? Yeah, what do you got to say?
So I was going to say that it's kind of a slippery slope because they can weaponize it. You have to ask yourself, how young are they going to use it for? Or, say, for Russia, for example, they could weaponize it to see any future wars that are gonna happen and use it as a weapon to win anything in life. Like, you don't know what their intentions are going to be. So, like, they ignored that little boy on the playground. What happens if he was going to grow up to be a murderer? Do you arrest him now or later on in life?
That's absolutely brilliant. Like, this movie, again, they use storytelling tricks to make it juicy. The dude is he's holding a murder weapon and he's about to kill somebody. I mean, we all know, like, the baby Hitler conundrum. You know what I mean? Like, well, that's a baby. Yeah? What do you guys say?
Yeah, I mean, what if they use it for other intentions? I mean, if they want to predict something else that's going to happen, instead of...
Bless you.
Instead of a mark, they can want to predict something like lottery, things like that, something that doesn't have anything to do with mark.
That's very, very...
So, I will thank you.
Yeah, that's the thing that we have to discuss, whether or not we think it's moral and ethical. We know what the ends are. We can all say it's written, this guy was about to kill that woman. And like in math, you take this as red, you know, take as fact, x equals 5, if that, then what else? Like, we know the system works 100% of the time. There's psychics in the tank. This dude was definitely about to murder somebody. The system is perfect. It has never been wrong. The system is so perfect that the federal government has a building and cops and copters and, like, gloves and stuff because the system is so perfect. Yes?
What about the moral of the three ladies telling the teacher just encapsulated in the inside tank?
That's one of the great questions about this. We never find out whether or not they are cool with what is happening. Is it okay to shave them bald and stick them in a spa in the bottom of a federal government building and hook up wires to them forever to save thousands of lives? We can all say no. What if it was you? What if it was your kid? What if it was your dad? Like, there are situations all the time where we as a society see the ends justify the means. On D-Day, the first people to land had a very low survival rate. They were the first people to take the beach. If they didn't do what they did, we wouldn't be living in a free world right now. So clearly, somebody thought that was a moral and ethical decision to do that, you know? So it's like, that's one of the nice things about morality and ethics is that, like, you think about this on 20 different layers. At the end, you don't even...
I wanted to say, I didn't watch the movie, but...
Don't worry about that. You get the idea.
Yeah, I wanted to say the words that are the police officers exempt from the murders that they commit? I don't know if it's further in the movie, does, like, Tom Cruise have to, like, go on the run or anything? Like, because the system might analyze the cops themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens if they become murderers later on?
Yes, that does happen. I can show you more of the trailer. Like we can get into that stuff later. But for now, I just think it's interesting to think of this as a perfect system. You know, like we can decide that. Like in Star Wars, we can decide that they've got laser swords. We don't have to think how many laser swords do they have. Like, where do the crystals from the laser swords come from? Are there enough laser swords? Should everybody have one? Are you taking a selfie of me or yourself? Are you going to listen to all the Joker murders? Okay, if anybody wants a picture of the Joker murders, go ahead. That's the nice thing about fiction. We just take things as read. As written. I think there's been a couple of interesting points raised here. You know, again, we see this technology used right before the murder. Is it right to have three ladies on the government payroll spying into all of our futures? Like, that's what's happening. Tom Cruise is in a room, and he's looking at people's thoughts. Like, I think the way the technology works is that the ladies can see through people's eyes in the past. That's why it's not perfect, and Tom Cruise doesn't know, like, what door. Because, like, I think the ladies are seeing through the eyes of the kid on the Ferris wheel. That's why we're seeing that stuff. Well, that kid didn't consent to that. Like, is it cool to have these people looking at all of our thoughts from the future if it stops crimes? What do you guys think? exactly. Yes, but with a time travel layer. Like, do the ancestors find the means? But was it? Is it Kant that says that, like, if something immoral is happening, it is not right or correct to commit an immoral act to stop that immorality?
That's right. Yeah. So that would be the categorical imperative.
Yes.
So by regardless of what the consequence is, if something is wrong, it's always wrong, irrespective of what might come of it. That's where you're getting at, right?
Yeah. Because I remember you talked about that last year, categorical imperative. So it's like, you know, they're committing a moral act, stop a moral act. Like, is that the only thing? Okay, so, you know, let me show you the rest of the movie trailer, though, because what happens is...
Joe, don't run.
The system makes a mistake. The ladies see Tom Cruise murdering someone. Perspective, it's interesting because suddenly this guy who wielded unlimited power over information, you see they do a lot to establish that he's very cocky and in control. He tells the girl on the radio to shut up. Like, the FBI, there's an FBI guy there, played by Colin, I forget his last name, Colin Farrell. He doesn't want anything to do with this FBI guy. He calls him a nasty name. Like, he's saying, like, someone else can get you coffee, you got a tour, I'm doing something important. So, like, from a storytelling perspective, it's very interesting to take a character from his highest high to his lowest low. You know what I mean? Like, master of information, stopper of crimes, like, arbiter of the future, to being hoisted by his own petard, the machine, these ladies and these machines who he used as tools are now coming after him. What did you want to say?
Probably that's something that happens really often with people that manipulate information on a daily basis.
Tell me more.
Yeah, for example, people start getting biases once they have a pattern of how do I in different situations. For example, I was reading an article in technology that people that develop websites that are related to adult content, they tend to have a certain tendencies of frustration or things like that.
Yeah.
Because they handle so if that information on a daily basis. That could happen to any case, But if he commits an error, or by watching all of this action over and over, what if that influences him to commit more?
Exactly. Or what if that influences him to ignore small clues that perhaps the system is wrong. The movie Minority, the title Minority Report comes from this. Sometimes these three psychics disagree and they put it to a vote. And much like the Supreme Court, it's not the law of the land, but Justice Sotomayor still gets the opportunity to issue a dissenting opinion. A minority report can be generated that says, I don't know if this guy's a murderer. So the unconscious bias, which is what you're talking about, of Tom Cruise is very interesting. Everyone he looks at is a murderer. You know what I mean? When he's looking through his goggles. So maybe there's someone he's not giving a chance. But you kind of bring up another interesting technological question here. I don't want to get too deep into it, but there is content on the web that is horrible. There's content on the web of completely innocent people being hurt, traded around on the dark web and such. I don't need to get too into it. Google and Facebook pay people to all day sit at a computer and go through flagged reports. If you see something terrible, for example, you can flag it. A crime being committed on Facebook Live, which unfortunately has happened. We all know what I'm talking about? Do it.
On Twitch.
On Twitch, on Facebook Live. horrible things.
Exactly.
You see that, you flag it. Somebody gets paid, somebody sits from 9 to 5 going through these reports and essentially viewing the worst of humanity. Is that a moral and ethical thing to do to that person if they're protecting the rest of us? What do you guys think? I don't want, I'm sorry I'm not being too specific. I don't want to get too deep into it. But yes, yeah, man.
I would say that it would depend on how much they're being paid.
Like, sure.
You would assume that they would get a larger paycheck because these people that you're talking about have mental trauma afterwards. That's what the reports say. That they come out like changed, like they're traumatized. They don't want to look at anything. Like, so I would expect them to be getting paid good money, but in fact they're getting paid like cents, like not really anything.
Yes. A lot of it's sort of like it's a very low paying job right now. Let's say you paid them $1 million a year.
I do it.
You do it?
Exactly.
Who would do it? Who would look at horrible crimes for $1 million a year?
Cops do it.
$10 million a year. A credit card that gives you unlimited power to purchase anything you want. Essentially an infinite money card. Exactly. Now that's an easy question to answer. Would you do it? The difficult question is it ethical to put someone in this position in the first place? To what? To protect your corporate profits? To keep people on Facebook? To keep people on YouTube and Twitch? Is it okay to pay a guy, not much money, to sit through reports, be exposed to horrors, experience vicarious trauma, so we can all watch PewDiePie? What do you think?
I think it is ethical because the person signed up for it. You know, like, they'll tell you, like, hey, listen, you might see some horrific stuff. You have to have the guts for it. It's sort of like a roller coaster. It's like, hey, you might not throw up, but if you're weak in the stomach, this isn't for you.
I think that's so interesting. Let's take a... Oh, yes, young man.
The forensic scientists, they view the stuff up close and personal, so if they aren't that traumatized by it, then the guy watching on the computer shouldn't be that traumatized.
They get paid more, don't they?
All right, let's assume so, yes. Like, you know, let's assume that, like, a forensic pathologist probably gets paid more. Because often you've got these jobs being offshored. You know what I mean? Like, I had another question about that. I just lost my thought. So we essentially have people that were paying very little money to experience vicarious trauma. But the other side of it is, what if one of those people finds evidence of an ongoing active crime? Is it okay to put them through this trauma if a greater good was accomplished? Say the rescue of a minor, rescue of somebody in captivity? Like, is that okay? I haven't heard from you guys yet. Like, what do you think of all this stuff?
I think that's fine.
You think it's fine?
Yep.
Okay.
Because there is real people that's saving the majority, so that's good enough.
I mean, we kind of all do it. You know what I mean? Maybe not to this level, but like, there are people that society depends on that aren't paid a lot of money to keep all of us comfortable. Like, where's everybody's clothes from? That like you're wearing right now. Exactly. See, I don't even need to go there. You know what I'm asking. That's technology and trade being used right now. Like, you couldn't have done this 500 years ago. We wouldn't have the capability to move these goods throughout the world. You know what I mean? But technology has essentially made it possible through the ability to move gigantic amounts of cargo all around the world to go to the cheapest place to get whatever you want done. And like, something we have to think about, and a reason you guys are in this class, is that are the very clothes on our back like the product of
technology, extracting the price from people. Who, to be fair, do take those jobs. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know, what do you guys think? Let's get some more thoughts. And it's okay, let's go back to this pre-crime thing. So like, did you want to say something before? Yeah.
I think it helps in terms of the person and how they take it. Because some people stand different levels of, some people have different personalities and they stand different levels of frustration in different cases. So I think there should be like an evaluation for that, but that doesn't exist. There should be one. For example, I used to work in the Dominican Republic in a call center. Mm-hmm. I used to work for Western Union, and everything was together to one. So you can imagine what the things that happened. And one of those frustrated people I used to call, thinking that they were calling to the United States, but they were calling to the Dominican Republic.
Mm-hmm.
So I think everything that is outsourced should have a level of quality control that's more accurate than the ones that we were calling today.
So you got paid to get like yelled at.
Yeah,
like you, exactly. Like, you know, I don't want to be too reductive, and like I apologize for being too reductive, but I think we can, you know, that's what I want to talk about. Uber. So Uber and Lyft have made it possible so that pretty much if you have a car, you can become a taxi driver. This did not exist when I was a kid. I remember being in college. And even in my 20s, and it was like very hard to go out and drink because of DUIs. I lived in Los Angeles, and there was a thing where on a Friday or Saturday night, one out of every three people was a drunk driver. So something amazing that Lyft and Uber did was they literally saving lives. That's the good story about Uber. Let's say you're caught on a corner and it's 2 a.m. and there's some creep following you and you need to get home. You can pull out your phone and you can push a button and a taxi can show up and take you to your parents' house or take you home or take you to safety. Like, what are some of the benefits of Uber and Lyft? Talk to me.
Obviously, right home.
Sure, yeah. It's cheaper than the yellow cab, right? Is it? What do you guys think?
Something depends.
You get discounts?
Yeah.
You ever get discounts from Yellow Cab? Coupon codes?
Depends on the market.
Depends on the what?
The market.
Supply and demand. Exactly. Depends on whether or not there's a surge. Yes, and you guys.
It's the same thing, because I have to take a cab at like 3 in the morning from Brooklyn to the Upper East Side, and it was like $60 or $70. Because everybody was trying to do the same thing at that time.
Yeah.
Surge
price? Oh, yes.
But I think someone told me that Uber or Lyft, like if you want to ride like around Christmas or New Year's, like they double or triple the price or something like that.
Sure pricing.
Not even that. It's like whenever they know like a situation is going on in the area, they take advantage of that and they like up the price.
Right, like if it's raining.
For example, like around the summertime, we were having power outages in certain areas like Manhattan, Brooklyn. They upped the prices to like a short ride could be like $20 to $30. When it's usually like $7 to $10.
That's exactly right. Now, obviously, you know, extrapolate to the larger situation. God forbid there was, and you needed to get out of where you were right away. The computer doesn't know that's happening. Like, that's what Uber and Lyft always say after. We didn't know. We didn't push a button that said, upcharge these people trying to get to safety. Suddenly 50 people wanted to ride on the same block, and the way surge pricing is we will charge more money because that incentivizes drivers to wake up, get in their car, and go service people. So like, well, the benefit of surge pricing is drivers make more money during surge pricing. That's the idea behind it. Someone else could say, why don't you hire a guy to watch the news? And if there's a surge happening, Google New York 45th and 5th and see if something's going on there. So that, like, there was a gigantic protest in the early days of the Trump administration at the airports. And Lyft specifically said, we will not be surge pricing people going to and from the airports because we know there's a huge protest happening.
we disagree with the Trump administration's position, and we don't want to profit off this. So it is possible, but let's discuss this from a moral and ethical perspective. You want a car, and do they have a moral responsibility to give you the price you think is fair? They set it all up. They built the app, and they hired the people. And it's kind of like, if you want a sandwich and you're a Comic-Con, sometimes you got to pay $9. Yeah?
I think for companies, it's not a moral or immoral point of view that they think about. It's more profit or is not, are we making profit or not? That's what they make it off. Because even they say that it's for the drivers, the surge pricing, but I have someone in my family who works for Uber and Lyft. I know that they take money based off of percentage.
Yes.
So if surge pricing, the price of the ride goes up, that means Uber and Lyft are making more money themselves.
Exactly. Yes. That's exactly correct. Yes.
And also some people might even argue that taking an Uber or Lyft is unethical, because if you look at the back in the days, Metallica's using an Uber, you're potentially taking away his money.
That's it. Exactly where I was going to move the conversation. So, like, Uber has made it so that you, if you own a car, you can become a taxi driver. Just like you were saying before, if the guy takes the job to sit at the computer and watch horrible stuff all day, well, they take the job. You were a customer service representative. People often yell at you, I imagine, and I'm sorry that happened. Like, but it's like, you know, you're duty. Only rage. When you take that job. But like, I think we all know that there are hidden costs to being an Uber or Lyft driver. You gotta get your own insurance. You gotta use your own car. Like, you set your own hours, which means that, I don't know, maybe you can drive around 18 hours a day, 7 days a week. Like, essentially, like, putting your own health second to make money first. You gotta pay for the gas. God forbid you get into an accident. I don't know. Maybe some of these policies have changed. I remember there was a time when Lyft was like, we'll lease you a car and you can drive that around. Well, what is your relative? Does your relative make a lot of money off this?
Depends on how long they work. And even right now, they have even changed the terms for the drivers. Like, they can't work whenever they want.
Interesting.
And there are certain areas, too. There are certain areas as well. For instance, like on uptown after 125th Street, there are certain areas where you cannot go and do any pickup or drop. You can just drop off, but you can't do any pickup. But there, it's just only for yellow taxis or for green taxis and stuff like that. They've made restrictions now.
The airports, that's exactly right. Yeah?
I'm a driver.
Tell us about, I'm blathering this whole time. Tell us things.
Yeah, now, you know,
there's
like a TNC.
Do you get gas reimbursement?
No, not at all.
It's only during the trip.
Yeah.
Whatever you spend during the trip is what you get back. And even
some stuff like this Uber and Lyft, they kind of like cheap driver.
Tell us.
Because like I remember I drive around and there was a nowadays they also remove the search. I don't think they don't search you like because when you like there's like a there's more requests than a driver, it search you like times two, times three. So if you like take a $20 ride, it will if there's like a very few drivers and it costs times three, then it will cost you like $60. That's the idea behind you. And yeah. And we get like 2.5 and they take like 0.5, something like that.
See, the interesting thing about what you said that I kind of linked to the movie you saw is that it's like, well, you can't really argue with the system. Like, you got ripped off. Like, you know, if this guy got ripped off in this story, what is he going to do? Please talk to me.
So, I know that even though not many companies do this, I know that there was one company when it started, Juvo, it's another driver's. They offer shares to the drivers themselves when they drove for them in the beginning of the company. So the drivers who are driving right now with those shares, they're worth much more now.
That's very cool. Now, I'll be honest. I stopped using Juno because Juno was more expensive. Does anybody else? See, that's the interesting thing about this technology, and it's kind of like with the Joker, or kind of like with pre-crime. Like, there's no easy answer here. Yellow cabs cost a fortune, and they wouldn't take you places. I remember this one time I was like so sick, I had like 104 fever, and I had to go home, and it was the 2006, so Uber wasn't a thing yet, and I'm like begging this driver, can you please bring me to Knightsbridge up in Queens? Like I'm not going up in Queens because I can't find anybody on the way back. I got to pay for that. I got to pay for all that gas. I'm like dying in the back of this car. And I'm like, how much money can I pay you to bring you? I paid like $110 to get home. And I went to the doctor the next day. I found out like a horrible infection. It was terrible, terrible, terrible. Like, so it's like, Uber has provided a societal good because it's employing people. And it's the kind of thing where if you have a car and you have a phone, you have a job. If you're desperate for money and you have to pay the rent, God forbid something happens and there's an unexpected medical bill and you need this money now. Like, if you have a car and you have a phone, would it be fair to say if you have a car and you have a phone, you can probably get a gig? Or am I, is that no. Oversimplifying?
No, actually there's a big process that you have to go through.
Tell me.
Because first of all, to drive for Uber or any taxi company, you need to get taxi plates.
Okay.
Otherwise you can't drive for them. Uh-huh. You have to go through a drug test, which takes you a long time.
What about a criminal background check?
Yeah, no, all that is included. It's a new system that they implemented. Now you have to go through background checks.
When did this happen?
Very recently. I think like 2 weeks ago now.
Okay. So now what does that make the rest of us think? That for 10 years they weren't doing criminal background checks? So we would get into a car with a stranger who might be a criminal? Like, I'm a temp. I go through a background check to like go to an office and push papers around all day and like write commercials and stuff. I'd go through a background check. A dude picking up my girlfriend in a neighborhood at 2 a.m.? Why didn't they check this guy's background? Here's what I'm going to guess. They didn't want to spend the money. I don't know if that's right. But in terms of this moral ethical debate, let's say it was for a second. I'm going to call on you guys. I'm so sorry I'm over talk. I apologize. Like, something you said before. Well, what's moral to a company? To make as much money as possible, as fast as possible. If anything, it's immoral to a CEO to deprive their shareholders who invested their money in your company, who bought shares of your company, who took your word that you would take the money that you were investing as a shareholder and use it as well as you could. Like, They took your money and on the promise and good faith that you would use that money wisely to produce a profit. Like, there are all sorts of industries, and the industry may change our moral calculus. For example, money that is used to develop a cure for a horrible disease. The guy who discovered insulin gave the patent to the world to make it free. He didn't want anybody to have to pay for insulin. And then all got screwed up. I'm talking much. I want to hear from you guys. Because I want to hear from you guys. No, I don't know this stuff.
I'd say probably with the whole verification process. It's probably a liability, because if you think about it, I think there was a recent report about a cryptocurrency exchange that sells, you know, cryptocurrency.
Sure.
They are whoever they use to verify people, that company got hacked. So for example, imagine in Uber's eyes, if now everybody who put their social in or put their information now in through their system to apply, which probably millions, gets exposed, that's also a bunch of lawsuits that they might not want to deal with. So for the shareholders, it would be something negative.
Perhaps ignorance is bliss. Maybe you don't want to know if your top performing drivers might have a criminal background because they're bringing you so much money. But then again, that's just me, some guy, just jawjacking here. Well, I want to hear what you had to say. I'm so sorry, I haven't called you in a while.
But at the same time, it could be reversed as well.
I'm sorry?
At the same time, it could be reversed as well.
Yes, exactly. Like, why don't you have to pass a criminal background check to get to hail an Uber? They could do it. Hey, if you want to use this app, give me your social security number. Give me your last couple of addresses. We've all gone through criminal background checks to get employment, to get IDs. It's a part of life.
Is it moral or right to expose these innocent drivers to perhaps the maniacs who are like calling them at 3 a.m. so they can get shuttled between murder scenes?
Yes.
I think, like, even when Uber started, they used to have, like, the same people at the door or whatever.
Yes.
Always.
Yes.
So that if people could track them, and if they were in trouble, they would have to. So even if they didn't, like, even if they didn't do a background check, they ensured safety of the passengers as well. So,
I'm sorry to cut you off. What was that Uber's fault that an innocent young woman who was intoxicated got into a car that she thought was an Uber? It was not. Yes?
I was just going to say we're just about up.
Oh my God, are we out of time? I'm sorry, I had more movies to show you guys. Is there like one burning last thought that like you got to say or you're going to pee your pants?
You know, regarding that issue, you know, with the girl.
Yes.
I think it depends on the fault of the state law. Because, in, you know, we go through like rigorous, drug tests, everything, right? And we have to do drug tests every 3-4 months. Maybe it's the, you know, like, kind of like fault of the state. I don't know. Because they can just have a car and just register through Uber, and they can just drive, not like here.
Yes. I'm sorry.
I wanted to ask a question about that. When the girl got in the car, couldn't you say it's Uber's fault because those old yellow cabs?